Welcome to the IVM Podcast Network.
Hello there. If you like listening to podcasts, then here's a cool suggestion for you. Check out Simplified. It's a podcast that takes a look at everything around the world and simplifies it for you so you can be smarter in front of your friends. Isn't that cool? So check out new episodes every Monday on the IVM Podcast app or any of the podcasting apps that you listen to.
You're listening to Keeping It Queer with Navin Narona.
Hello and welcome to Keeping It Queer, everybody. It's an all-new episode, an all-new day, and today I have one of the most interesting guests I have wanted to get on the show. We have Divya Roop. Hi, Divya Roop.
Hi.
He blogs and makes YouTube videos on his channel, which is called Homo Wanderer,
Yes. Which
is it's a new twist on wanderlust altogether. And Divya Roop identifies as a gender non-conforming person. He's okay with whatever gender you assign him with. Doesn't matter. Yeah. And we'll learn more about his colorful life in this podcast. So welcome, Divya Roop. Thank you, first of all, for making some time out and coming here.
My pleasure, Navin, and thank you so much for inviting me.
So when I first came to the gay scene, you know, like, I was really skeptical about how I'm carrying myself and all, because sometimes gay men tend to judge, and I'm not one of the best dressers around. But you are, and, like, you know, I look at you and you're so fierce and so beautiful, and I think it takes a lot to be expressive in the society that we live in. It's difficult sometimes, but you yet carry on and you persevere, and we'll learn about that. So first, take us back to your early days. How was it growing up?
My growing up had been in parts. The reason why I call myself Homo Wanderer is because I have lived in different parts of the country already. Mm. Born in Ranchi, raised in Shimla, studied in Chandigarh, started working in Delhi, moved to Mumbai. So, like, quite a lot of parts, and in between some places that I have.
So which men are the best looking according to you, after wandering so much?
I think I have found a reason for every state to have a good-looking man. So,
let's go state-wise. Okay, first, start off with Ranchi.
Oh, Ranchi people, they are brainy.
Brainy, okay.
Yeah.
Putting the bookworm angle.
Yeah, I think that's one of the interesting things, because when you get to have a conversation with someone on an intellectual level, that really boosts your internal, you know, morale, as well as it's kind of turn on as well.
Sapiosexual. All right, next we have Shimla on the list.
Cuteness and the innocence of the people.
Yeah, you can't argue with party simplicity.
Like, they'll be like, Baiji, please. And you'll be like, okay, please.
Mari dalo. Alright, from there you went to Chandigarh.
Yes, their friendliness and their liveliness, it's something like you have to enjoy it. You will enjoy it for sure.
Yeah, I've been to Chandigarh and I think it's a whole new perspective on life. Like, they're just full on out there.
Yeah, like,
having
there's
fun.
No reason for energy as well. They'll still be
energetic. Still be energy, yeah. Early morning.
Yeah, like, oh, kitna paoji. Good.
Very nice. And then Delhi.
Delhi people, that's where I think my preferences started defining themselves.
Oh my god, like, Delhi is so bad that you have to actually reconsider your orientation.
No, not really considering my orientation, but actually that's when I came in terms with my sexuality. So I became more precise and more, you know, confined as to what I'm looking for. So I think in terms of men in Delhi, I think they have a charm which is mostly reflected by their face, and you can see that, you know, this person is really charming. So I think charm would be one thing that I think for Delhi people.
And the final place you wandered to is Bombay.
Bombay, I think it's the heart and soul. I think every man you find around, yes, there are some people that I don't want to be considered along with, but that's a separate.
That's a part and part of the whole.
There's always one or two exceptions, so let that be. But apart from that, I think the people in Mumbai are quite welcoming, very warm. And no matter how much time I have heard that Delhi is like dil of India or something, but I think the actual heart lies in Mumbai.
Mumbai. This is a proper hot spot.
Yeah.
And so when you said you traveled to different parts of the country, so you said Delhi was where you actually came to terms with your orientation. And how did that happen?
So that stems back, or rather I should say, the route eventually had started in Shimla. When I was in Ranchi, it was like I was quite young. I think till fifth standard. So I wasn't really, even thinking about what am I or what am I not. However, there are instances even related to Ranchi where I remember faintly when I used to play badminton with my sisters, or if I used to play teacher with my sisters or my friends around, I used to get called by my cousins or other boys around that ladki hai kya. Because that was something that was unusual for boys.
But
there.
Playing badminton.
Yes, exactly. I was trying to play sports. I'm not a sports person, but I was trying to play sports, and still people had problem with that. So in Ranchi, because Ranchi had been a part of Bihar. Bihar, the one word that I can think of when you come to Bihar, or when you can think of Bihar, it's male chauvinism.
That's true.
So
hardcore, like very naughty.
Yeah. So like mard aisa hoga. And if he does anything else, wo ladki hai. So like
I like how this gender thing also comes to the sport, you know, because I think sport is something which is the most unisexual thing in the world.
True.
Just have fun while playing it, but even there gender made its ugly head come in and like ruined everything. Because badminton, dude, like Deepika Padukone's father is one of our most prized possessions as a country, you know.
Exactly.
As a badminton player. And even now we have so many amazing players in the country.
True. So I think this discrimination of gender in terms of what you do in your life, that is something that I started learning from Ranchi itself, where men are supposed to go for shopping for groceries, women are supposed to stay in house and cook and things like that. So I think the discrimination about work as per gender, I started learning there. And eventually when I moved to Shimla, that's when I started finding myself not fitting, because now I'm in 10th and passing on the grades every passing year, and I realized that I somehow do not fit. I mean, I know that I'm just a boy. I used to think that I'm quite pricey and I'm a prince of Prince Charming or something, and they won't understand my standards. So
let but that also happens, right? When you move from one place to another, the whole struggle of having to find new friends and start anew, that takes a toll on your psyche as well. I think that's one thing.
I think for me, it had never been a difficult situation to make friends for some reason, because back then, yes, moving schools or changing school to a completely new state can be quite, different experience for someone. But for me, it wasn't that much because my father was principal.
Okay. So the school moves with you.
Yeah. So basically, everyone had to be good to me. Like no matter what they think about me, they have to be good to me. Otherwise, they're doomed.
They must like come to you and like, how big is the cane actually? Have you ever seen firsthand?
Well, no, not that never happened.
No caning.
No caning happened. But yes, even back then I was quite studious. I was always engrossed in my computer and my books and things like that. So,
but was it because your dad was principal, so you had to like keep up with the expectations, or like just because you were studious in general?
I was studious in general. I mean, for some reason, books were one of the best things that I could find. I think during the whole time when I was not able to understand myself, I think book was one of the things that I could find solace into. So I would read Cinderella, I would read, yeah, quite girly options though. But yes.
Now you think about it.
Yeah, so those kind of stories I used to study.
But fairy tales are in general like something you look up to, you know, like as a kid. I don't think gender has anything to do with it, but the beauty of it, like the charm of the fact that somebody had to like have this kind of wish, like true love's kiss.
True.
And magic and like Cinderella story, for example.
Honestly, I always wanted a magic for some reason. And honestly, in the childhood, Lord of the Rings was not there, and Harry Potter was not there. So I eventually got to know about them, and eventually those became my favorite instead of Cinderella and things. That was the thing that gave me the hope or the magic, or kind of,
inspires you in a way.
Yeah, like it gives me an idea that, okay, something magical is there about love. Eventually I got to know there's nothing magical about love. It is only practicality that you need to take care of.
That's true again, yeah.
But
it's only for the first 5 months. First 5-6 months.
5 months? Okay.
I have endured more.
You have endured more. For me, it lasts 5 days. That's it.
Oh, shit.
No, just kidding. But yeah.
So future husband for the room.
Oh, that reminds
me. Yeah, 5 days.
Yeah, 5 days. Impress me or else go.
All right. So then you were in Shimla back then.
Yeah. So in Shimla, what happened is we were growing up and... as I said, I was quite studious. I was not really much into sexual fantasies as I used to find in my friends.
Hmm.
They would be like, oh, wo ladki dekh yaar. I'd be like, ladki hai? Kya hua? And they'd be like, tere ko kuch nahi hota. Tere ko kuch nahi hota. I'm like, well, whatever.
Yeah, and then like for gay kids, it's usually so weird because then they're like, you see their body part, this body part is so amazing, and I'm like, I find nothing. But then I have to pretend because I'm with the straight boys. I'm like, ha, achha, very nice. I'm like, achha, pagal hai. And my friends be like, ha, tu kya karega, bata. I'm like, nahi, izzat karunga.
Exactly. So even back then, like I remember there had been instances where I realized that there's something different about me. Like, for example, there's this one very interesting instance. I somehow have a feeling that people in Himachal have already tried everything with their cousins or friends or something with the same-sex partner, but no one is going to accept it. They're all straight.
What happens in the mountains stays in the mountains.
Yeah, stays in the mountains.
Brokeback mountain for real.
No, it's kind of more like bushes. Mostly happens in bushes.
Oh, shit.
So... what happened one fine day, I was sitting in the class and the teacher was not there. And a friend of mine, I had kind of hots for him because he was tall, dark and kind of good built body.
But did he write good essays though?
No. At that time, I was not really considering that because whatever was happening was quite unusual for me. So
too fast, too soon.
Yeah. So what happened is that he was sitting right next to me. He was my bench mate, so as to say.
Dream come true.
No, he used to sit with me because I was more studious and I was much help for him. So what happened is I was just reading something in my book and he came close to me for some reason and came closer and he reached my neck. His lips were almost touching my neck.
Okay.
And he exhaled.
Oh.
And there was like...
a thousand deaths.
And I was like... what the fuck are you doing right now? And he's like, kuch hua na, kuch hua na. I was like, what exactly are you trying to do? Let me just clarify that. He's like, nahi nahi, kuch hota hai, mere ko pata. I was like, have you been experimenting something? So I was like, control the way, control, don't feel anything
this
right
now. This kid is directly into foreplay. I like the game plan.
Yeah.
Just like blow wind at people and make them fall in love with you.
I was like, can't control, but somehow I managed. So these kind of things which actually hinted me that there's something different about me. I remember one more thing where there was this one time we were sliding down through that jhula where you slide. And a friend of mine, she was ahead of me and I was coming from the down from the ground, and what happened is my head accidentally went into her skirt. That was embarrassing, totally embarrassing.
So you had your eyes open or closed? What happened?
The moment I realized her skirt is right above my head, my eyes were closed and I went down running.
Okay, that's the okay, went down running.
Yeah,
okay,
like cool. No, can't go up, like let her go and then I will go.
But going down, you know, as it
not
mean.
On her, not on her, going down okay. From the stairs.
Okay.
So yeah, these kind of things which kind of entered me, like, okay, my classmates are much more interested in girls. And right now if my roommate or sorry my classmate would have been there, he might have been like
kuch hota hai na.
Yeah. But that didn't happen to me. However, when the boy came close to my neck, that was completely different. I mean, I was almost head over heels inside. Something was happening. So I knew that there's something different about me.
Yeah, so similar thing, like, you know, in school, when you first find this out, like, sports used to happen for us back, yeah. I remember. And most of the boys used to line up for the girls' 100-meter race because, you know, girls run and their boobs apparently do something and guys go crazy about that. So I stood up with all my friends and I'm watching this. And next thing was a boys' race. And all of my friends left and I'm like, guys, go, let's wait and watch this as well. So yeah, I think that's when they first find out.
I think that was the moment of realization for me that I am not one of those. I mean, these people do not won't understand what I'm thinking. I think they think completely different. Eventually, thankfully, my father was quite tech savvy, so back in those days, internet was quite a rare thing. And my father had got the internet connection, which was dial-up, like 5 kbps. Now, when you come to think of it, it's like, no, not happening. Like, what exactly is going on here? So, that time, we had created a Gmail account. I had my different Gmail account. For some reason, I created a different Gmail account. And in the spam folder, once I found out there was an email saying, lots of women are waiting for you
in your vicinity.
Yeah, come and have a chat or look at them and things like that. So I went onto the profile and I was like, women naked? What are they doing? How? Like, why? What? And because it was a porn site. And since it was a porn site, no matter how underdeveloped Indian websites would have been, it was a Western website and Western people still had that secret category back then where there used to be gay porn as well. And
I don't think that's that secret though, like, it's pretty much out there.
But previously, this is something that I'm talking about in like 90s, maybe around 98, 99, something around that. So back then, gay porn is not something that was too quite open and wide open, because now it's much more, you know, there, out there. But back then it was like a small category. You will find all MILF and this category and that category. And then there will be a small category says gay. So I was going through all the categories and eventually
it's almost like how I hide my porn on computer where it's like some other folder and then there's some porn in there. It's like porn side but the small sub side.
Exactly. So that's how it was, and I eventually ended up looking out at the gay porn and I was like, two men, oh my god,
this seems right,
this seems something that I would do. So but that kind of freaked me out as well, because I realized I never saw something like that.
The imagery is inspiring.
It was tempting, it was you know, inviting, it was kind of me. But I was scared by the thought that I never heard about two guys. So is that right? Is that moral? That's the first thing that came to my mind.
Correct.
And the whole thing came into my head, like how I have only seen a man for a woman. Mother, father, uncle, aunt, grandpa, grandma. I never heard a man and a man. What would that be termed as? How will you term it as? What is it? What exactly the relationship is? And I was freaking out. And somewhere I was also enjoying, because this is something that I am, but not ready to accept it. So this phase where you were a teenager trying to understand.
That's the weirdest phase, because then you like, you want some of that, you know, like you like the male body or the, in terms of a female gay person would be like, oh, I like the female body. But at the same time, society's, you know, the whole gender stereotype is so strong. Like, even when you're kids, you know, like how if you have a friend who's a girl, who's a small girl, you're like, ah, you'll grow up and get married and all. That idea is planted in us when we are kids, but nobody says, oh, two guys, Monday get married, you know, because they're like, oh my god, we can't even say that. So that also is because the confusion comes from the fact that we have to live in this world where male female is the ideal. couple.
True. And apart from that, one more thing that I think was causing this kind of confusion. Thankfully, I don't see this kind of confusion in the current period, because a lot has been spoken about, a lot has been talked about.
Correct.
So people are aware as to there is something called homosexuality or bisexuality, and people are ready to understand or take a time to understand for themselves. Back then, I was in a village. It was a small village where there's no such exposure.
Correct.
I mean, I have had stories coming from my friends where they have done things with their roommates and kind of homoerotic. And they have done all of that. They have proudly told it to me. But they will still identify themselves as straight. So no matter what they do, they will be straight. They are interested in girls. They're interested in bouncing boobs and flappy
vaginas.
Yeah,
I don't think anybody likes flappy vaginas. But yeah.
I have no idea. They're kind of fantasies, whatever. So that was there, and I had no one to talk to. I had no idea that. Who am I going to speak to about it? If I tell someone that, you know, I'm interested in boys, I was scared either they are going to use me.
Yeah.
Thinking,
or abuse you.
Or abuse me. So I had no idea what am I supposed
to
do.
And that whole struggle of not having a term to even give that, you know, when you don't even know what you're going through and not being able to put a definition on that.
Exactly.
It actually corrode you from the inside. It can actually affect you.
True. And a funny thing is, you know, I thought that I could speak to friends of mine and tell them, but my father was principal.
Correct.
If I tell it to anyone, the first thing that comes to my head is my father will be questioned as to...
And when they spread the news also, he principal ka beta hai.
Exactly. And it was a small town. It wasn't really a big city where everything will be covered under the blanket. It was a small town. If the word goes out, it will, you know, burst like a fire and spread around.
Soon everybody knows.
Yeah. So I was not ready to take a risk at that point of time. So I was like, keep it in yourself. Don't talk, don't discuss, like it was in America's army, don't, what was that? Don't say, don't tell, something like that?
Yeah,
something.
Don't ask, don't tell.
Don't ask, don't tell, yes. Yeah. So that was how it was for me. And I eventually realized that, no, I need to figure out more. So, being the bookworm, being the studious person, I started spending more time online, reading about homosexuality, trying to find out what exactly is it about. Let me also put this in right now. My family is a spiritual family. And we follow a guru, a saint, and... according to whatever I have known about him, or whatever I have read about him or understood him, he was one of the people who knew almost, not really almost, he actually knew everything. And he had the knowledge of almost more than 100 languages. He had written more than 5,000 songs. He had written and composed all of the songs. He had described each and every word as to what is the origin of the word for each and every language.
Very intense.
Very, very knowledgeable person. And not just that, he had studied so much. He was highly intellectual in a spiritual way. So a lot of things he was aware about, and he has spoken about, and he has told to people as to impart the knowledge. And I thought that a person who is so highly knowledgeable must have known about homosexuality, must have said something about homosexuality. I have to find that one thing, because if I have to speak to my family and stand up to them and tell them that this is who I am, I need to find something that he has said.
Yeah, intellectual backing is always important.
Yes, and considering my family believes in him completely, if I find anything... that he has said, and if I put that across to them, they will have to understand. Surprisingly, he never said anything.
Damn. Because he never acknowledged it, or what exactly?
So, I was trying to find this, and this is interesting actually. I never found anything from him. However, my Jiju, he is French and living in Canada. When he got to know about it, this is much after when I started studying about myself. When he got to know about it, he tried to find, he also did the same thing. He tried to find if there's anything our guru has mentioned about it. And he told me, he found one story where a person approached our guru and asked him about something similar. So there's only one thing that my guru had mentioned. He never said anything apart from that. The only thing that he had mentioned was a phrase from Vedas, which says vikriti evam prakriti.
Okay, which means?
Which means something which is deviated from the normal or so-called perceived natural is also natural. What essentially means is sometimes we see people born with two joint heads, or sometimes we see people who are not completely developed their limbs. They are deviated from normal. They are deviated from the so-called natural, but they're still a part of it. They have been born through the nature.
And just the way of living life changes quite drastically, and sometimes a little bit, but not too much.
Yeah. But in the end, in the essence, everything is a part of the nature.
Yeah.
And there's no one in the world who is supposed to deny them the life that they deserve.
That's a lot of information in one small, a couple of words, I think.
Exactly.
That's,
So that's interesting about Sanskrit as well, because in Sanskrit, one phrase can define a lot of things. Which a person has has to understand, and the problem is that everyone's understanding is limited.
So whatever, they never really know the full extent of the term.
Exactly. So whatever they want to believe in, they believe in that much portion, nothing apart
from
that.
That defines religion in many ways.
Exactly.
People use what they want to use and keep the better parts.
True. You will find all the religions that have been, you see today, they have all been modified, and everyone's, the people who came in power and what they perceived or what they understood about it, they defined it according to that, and everyone understood completely crooked and different version of what the religion
was.
Yeah,
as per your convenience.
Exactly. So, jab tak mera kaam chal raha hai, I'm fine with it.
I think, yeah, so lot of like, for example, a lot of scriptures say that, you know, you have to help people who are trying to spread the good word, but they also say help the poor people at the same time. So what you see happening is they spread the good word, those people get more money than actual poor people who are in need, you know.
Exactly.
So they are like sitting in castles right now of all kinds, and they have like world heritage sites made of religious sites, but then I don't understand why this dichotomy exists.
Exactly. And if you I think we are getting into religion, so let me just bring this up as well. Considering when you mentioned that, you know, there's a lot being said that help the poor, but still people are throwing money on the temples and things like that. If you remember, there's a very famous story of Krishna, where Krishna says, he interrupts a puja for Indra. He says that, why are you praying Indra? This is his job.
Yeah.
He is supposed to rain. You'd rather of praying to Indra, pray to the mountain if you really want to, because that is giving you so much of resources.
Yeah.
So in the essence, what Krishna had tried to mention here is that praying the Lords is not really the important thing. Serving your nature, serving your people, that is more important than anything else.
That's what matters.
But eventually, the pundits and the people who came into power, they drove it away. I mean, Krishna, the Lord himself, said something, but still, humans had the power to drive it away from
entirely,
it.
Yeah.
Exactly, and completely make it their own personal benefit.
Like even if you see the Catholic Church, like one of the major incidences that happened in the Bible is where there's a temple of God in the Jewish temple, and a lot of people are selling and buying stuff over there, and Jesus, who's like the main hero of the Bible, comes in and drives everybody out and hits them and everything, saying, "Ki, this is my father's house, you can't do all these illegal businesses here." Cut to 2000 years later in the church today, you have all these people selling something or the other in some other way, and that like, you know, they read about that passage in the church, but they disregard the whole the whole meaning of that. I don't understand what is that about.
That has happened quite a lot, and honestly, the more... So when I started learning about myself, as I mentioned, I was looking for the scriptures. I was looking for the, examples that can help me understand either I am wrong, either I am right. Either of the two. Because when you're a child, you see it in black and white.
Correct.
There's no gray. So either you want to know that it is right, either you want to know it is wrong. So I was looking for the answers. And all I got is there's nothing about it. I studied about Hindu scriptures. And Hindu scriptures, I found out Manusmriti, where there are laws which define as to punishments for same-sex relationships. However, on the contrary, you see that there are same-sex relationships described in a Kama Shastra, which means that people were aware about same-sex relationships and they have actually rather said what are the ways of having.
So these were the people having fun, but the ones who were jealous and angry wrote the Manusmriti is what essentially.
Exactly. So if you have ever heard about Devdutt Patnaik and what he has talked about, so he has mentioned that there had been different sects within Hindu cult. So there were people who used to enjoy bhog and vilas, and there were people who were who will enjoy celibacy. Okay, and both of them were never considered incorrect or wrong.
To each his own, like to apna
exactly.
Maza kar, apna maza kar.
Yeah, so there's one group who will enjoy dance, sing, and
make merry.
Food. There are lots of food in the system. So there's one side of that, and then there was another side where it's all dry and they're all lean and dhyan and sadhana. So there's two vast differences amongst the same kind of people.
And these two worlds can coexist, but when they collide is when problem happens, because one cannot force the other's lifestyle on each other, and that thing sometimes, because right now you look at this current government and they use Manusmriti as a leaflet for like governing, which sometimes is scary, because the way they talk about women in that, you know, how they are supposed to be subjective to their man, and that is essentially what the Quran, Torah and Bible also preach for that matter, you know, like how I was saying how misinterpretation happened, because we have books in Bible which say that no, a man should not lie with a man, as he lies with a woman then he must be stoned to death. In the same vein, they also talk about how if a woman is not a virgin on the honeymoon night, then she should be dragged to a father's house and stoned in front of him.
Exactly.
I don't see anybody doing that. So, you know, to your convenience, when you use those passages to like hurt people, that's when religion stops being religion and starts becoming something much worse. Becomes terrorism in many ways. No?
Exactly. There's one more thing now that you have brought up this, I think it was Leviticus where
Leviticus was
mentioned.
Correct.
So, I was going through one of the very interesting videos of Anna Hathaway where she has spoken about a family member being gay,
and she's a very strong supporter.
Yes, she has advocated very strongly in strong words.
Yeah,
I love her. I wish I was straight, but anyway.
We still have Devil Wears Prada.
Yes, of course. So there was this one Facebook post about it, and there are comments on that. Now there was this one person who had used this phrase: "A man should not lie with another man," and blah blah blah, and a very intelligent person, I wish he was gay, but he was married to a woman and he is old and has kids. he has mentioned on the comments that you have no idea what the original reason for these testaments were there. First of all, about abomination. If you go by the Hebrew culture or the language back then, abomination was not really a word which is supposed to be sin. Abomination is something which is not a part of our culture, but could be in other cultures. So something that we do not want to practice, or we do not practice ourselves, but it has been there and it is there.
Yeah.
Okay. Nothing wrong about it, nothing right about it.
But you don't do it.
You don't do it.
Correct.
So that was actually what abomination was, that you prohibit yourself from doing that. Okay. Now, another thing that it mentions is a man should not lie with another man as he would with a woman.
Yeah.
He explained back in those days when Jesus was actually preaching everyone about Christianity, or not really Christianity because it became Christianity later on. When he was preaching people about...
He's preaching himself, like, you know, I am everything, guys. I'm the guy. I take a dig on religion all the time, but...
Yeah,
like,
I think it's always fun at times. So, at times.
Until a tissue goes up your bum.
Yeah, and you don't want people to start firing on you, you know. So, yeah. So, this man mentioned that back in those days, same-sex relationships were not as it is today. Today, same-sex relationships are more about love and togetherness and partnership. Back in those days, actually, same-sex relationships were mostly as prostitution. If you go back in those days, kings used to have slaves, male and female, where they used to sleep around with anyone randomly, whoever they find tender. So when
slave
Jesus,
of the day, let's see who does a massive wheel and is just like rotating, who gets to sleep with me today?
Exactly, like Game of Thrones basically happening there. So in order to stop that prostitution or sexual abuse of men, that term was brought into the light, as to a man should not you know, have sex with another man.
Like they would do with a woman, like, you know, essentially. They're saying, don't treat man or woman bad. in a way of
not saying, having sexual abuse. Not treating someone like that.
But look where we ended up now.
And now we are just ruining ourselves.
Alright, Divya Roop, we've had a very intense first part conversation, and we'll pick up from where we stopped earlier. We'll take a small break and come back soon. Alright, we're keeping it queer and we're having fun.
We are.
We're discussing intense stuff, but we're having
intense
fun. We'll see you soon. Yep.
Hi, I'm Amit Verma, the host of the weekly podcast, The Seen and the Unseen. In my show, I examine the seen effects and the unintended consequences of public policy and private action. I show how policies meant to help the poor often end up hurting the poor. I've done episodes so far on demonetization, GST, surgical strikes, immigration and MRP. And I will continue my forensic assault on the truth in the weeks to come. Catch the show every Monday on iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcast app. And go to seenunseen.in for all the latest updates.
Okay, welcome back to Keeping It Queer. And even in the break, we were discussing so much about religion and stuff, which we should keep out of this conversation because then we don't want alienating people. But I think it's a very tricky conversation in general, because how can you support something that condemns you sometimes? And sometimes people go off the rail without even understanding what the context is. So we were talking about the whole the guru thing, and that's when you realize there's nothing he said about the whole thing.
Exactly. So when I realized that he has never mentioned directly about homosexuality, that's the point when I realized there is a gray area. And if it is not wrong, it is not right, then at least the least that it could be is normal. I mean, if you consider stealing, that is still not acceptable.
But stealing for your hungry kid, you know, in that situation.
Exactly. Then it makes a bit more sense.
Yeah, because you never say, like, even the most wildest of crimes have some kind of, you know, justification, which we still use in the court of law sometimes, you know. Like, if you murder someone in self-defense because they were trying to kill you, then it's not exactly murder. It's because it didn't really...
Self-defense.
Yeah, so that also, again, is a gray area. And we skim over this. We just see that as a person, we look at them as murderers or thieves, or in our case, homosexuals who are just violent and want to just have gay sex. That's all.
I think the exact word that I come across all the time is perverts.
Perverts, yeah.
So, like, you tell people that I'm gay. Oh, you're a pervert.
You, like, put it in the bum and all. This is
like, no, I'm, I really don't want to see you naked. Like, no.
Yeah.
So, this is interesting. So, even throughout my childhood, when I was growing up, when I was trying to accept myself and learning about the things, I gathered, I summed up all the information that I could inside of me, because I knew one day I'll have to blast.
Correct.
And when I'll blast, I will stand on the ground where there's no one who can pull that ground off from me. So I prepared myself. I think I keep on telling people as well, whenever I come across people, young people from different parts of the cities where they are living in very remote area and they're not sure as to how they can come out of a closet or how they can get out of the dual life. I keep on telling them, the only thing that can help you stand your ground is the knowledge.
You empower yourself with words and with understanding of what you're coming from.
Exactly. Today, I'll be very honest, I don't think physical power holds as much power than a mental power can do.
That's true.
That reminds me, the incident that had happened, I'm sorry, I'm bringing this up already. So the incident that had happened in Kar.
Correct.
That was a demonstration of someone's physical power. However, eventually, the winning side was the one who used the brain.
I think we should actually, this is such a vague way of referencing the incident at Kar, but I think we should talk about it in detail. So I want you to lead the whole story and tell us what happened.
So this was a quite, considering Mumbai is quite a queer friendly or LGBT friendly place, and Bandra out of that is one of the places where you will find a lot of gay people around.
Chilling,
like if you want to cruise around, just go to Bandra. So
tip of the day.
Yes, tip of the day. So
in a few episodes ago, we have mentioned Andheri station as a hotspot, but nice, we're getting more geographical.
Yeah. I think Andheri station has a different kind of demography.
And it's up to you to decide now. Just
catch a fast train. I would associate it with Bandra. So there was an event about LGBT community, some movie screening and things like that. And I went, there was a break in between. I went to get some cigarettes. Smoking is injurious to health. I went to get some cigarettes outside, and the only cigarette shop nearest was in a chawl area. And
I'm very familiar with that area because I used to work there back then.
Yeah.
And I remember how weird and shady it is, because one second you're in a nice cultural hotspot, next second you're in like the heart of Mumbai essentially.
Yeah, like you go there and you'll be like, okay,
yeah,
this is the other side. So
this is where they tell you not to go.
Not to go. But no, I think that was one of the unfortunate days that I had to go through. I went there. When I was returning back, there was this one drunk man who just stood by right in front of my face. This is a very bad way of expressing it, but he was almost as close as that he was about to kiss me. Like that close to me.
It smelled alcohol from his breath.
Quite a lot. It felt like he has actually taken a shower with the beer. And not to a beer, but you know,
tara, something.
That kind of thing. It was horrible. And he slipped his hand and touched my crotch. And out of reflex, self-defense, I slapped that person quite hard. Next thing, I was being beaten up by a mob of 6 people from behind.
All his friends, essentially.
Yeah. So they all started beating me up, and my clothes were torn apart. They used a bamboo stick. They were bringing stool. They broke a stool actually on my back, and
there was no one around with you.
My friend who was accompanying me, he also endured some injuries while running back to the venue because he went to find some help. He had no idea what to do. I think that's the best thing he could do. He ran to the venue to get some help. However, by the time they could come out and reach out to me, by the time the damage was done. And there was one woman who came out from the crowd. I mean, I really don't understand. People were looking around. They were seeing that I'm bleeding. My clothes are being torn apart. No one thought that they could at least stop them or at least ask what happened. No one. And it's not like it was something in the midnight where there's no one around. It was broad midday.
Yeah.
And everyone was out there in the market buying things and sitting nearby. No one.
Just turned a blind eye.
Everyone, I think instead of being blind eye, everyone was looking.
They take that some kind of entertainment for them in their lives.
Yeah.
And that's the thing. I think it's a very common situation across the world. I don't think it's a Mumbai specific or an India specific thing, because we've become so immune to violence at this point. Sometimes we don't, like, people we see, like, we see archive footage of people getting murdered and, like, literally getting stabbed and stuff, and nobody comes to their rescue, you know. People are getting raped and nobody stops.
Exactly.
Because it's part of life now, apparently, and that's not how we're supposed to live. We are supposed to coexist and respect each other, but this incident shows how shallow we are. And, like, you know, we always think that in a city like Mumbai we are probably safer, and you know, you now know that it's not that easy, you know. You could have violence coming, because even see, I look at America and Brazil, two countries that have gained independence in terms of gay rights. They've fought for years, but even now you see so many trans women, so many gay and lesbian women inside the house, they'll come and beat them up. Like, the audacity of it.
True.
Like, you know, we're not having sex in your houses, so just leave us be. But Brazil, you see people going to the house to open the door, somebody comes from the back, stabs them and runs away. And that's it. That the person's bled to death and nobody's come to help him because nobody cares.
Exactly. And that is actually, that I don't think, I mean, to be very honest, for me, as a person, you know, I'm skinny. Taking a hit from a stool or getting beaten by the bamboo stick.
Painful as fuck.
It's painful, but I was still standing my ground. I have actually kicked one of the guys in the balls. I fought, and they tried to put me down. They tried to kick me in a way that I'd fall down, but I didn't. Because I held my ground in any possible way that I could. However, that was not the point that really disheartened me. When people beating me is something that I was not disheartened about, I was rather thinking that this might happen one day or the other, because that's how the people are around. Instance, and they don't think getting violent. They don't think about getting violent in the next moment.
Plus, that guy was being homoerotic himself. Like, he was grabbing your crotch and everything. What was his business again? Isn't that molestation?
Exactly. And no one will notice that because they don't see it. I mean, someone standing next to you, so close to you, even if he touches somewhere on your body part, no one else will notice if someone is that close. But yes, the more disheartening or disappointing thing for me was how shallow or how less of a human being we have become, that we can see and watch and enjoy someone getting beaten up, molested, or getting their clothes torn apart, but no one wants to even
intervene,
utter a word. So I was quite disappointed about that. Thankfully, a woman came in between, and she dragged me out of that, took me away on the other end of the road, said that wait here for some time, let them go and things like that. Even then, one guy was actually running behind me with a bat. So that all happened. I realized, as I mentioned, that physical violence did a lot. Yes. And I had to go through a lot of mental trauma. I used to get panic attacks. I used to get, suddenly I will faint on the middle of the road if I see people around. And I will randomly start crying or getting worried that people are around.
So only imagine how traumatic the whole experience was.
It was, honestly, kind of sending down the chills through my spine. So I had no idea. I mean, I went to doctor to get tested for any broken bones, but I couldn't stand the point that there are people around. I left immediately, almost immediately, as soon as I entered the hospital.
But you turned the tables around on them, and
eventually I realized
it took some time also to get the whole.
Yes, when all this happened, I was so disheartened, as I mentioned, because of the people around, how they behaved. I wrote a blog about it, and I mentioned that today, if a woman's clothes are torn apart, it's a molestation. If a man's clothes are torn apart, it's just a beating. Nothing much. Why? if a woman's breast is touched by a man inappropriately, that's molestation. If a man's crotch is touched by another man, that's, by law.
But I think Divya Roop just actually transcends gender also, you know, in a lot of ways. You see, like, the thing that happened with the Nigerian girl in Bangalore, for example. She was beaten up and cornered, and Bangalore, which you also look as one of the more progressive cities in the country, you see the shallowness of humans as we actually sit and enjoy, you know. A lot of people were the spectators who are watching this Nigerian girl getting beaten up, stripped naked in front of everybody else, only a girl. So I think that gender thing, I think, is nowhere in question, because as a humankind, as a whole society in general, I think in India we are really fucked up.
That
and
is true.
And we have to call it out. We can't just go, ki, haan, it's again one of the things that happened.
Exactly.
But no.
And the reason why I mentioned about this gender thing here in specific is because when I was thinking about what all I can do, if I go ahead and charge a complaint against them, will they consider it as a molestation, or will it be only a physical assault? So eventually it ended up being a physical assault only. It cannot be molestation because laws specifically define that rape or molestation can happen with women only.
Okay.
So
that is terrible, actually.
Yes. Even though men are being raped, there had been instances of corrective rape for gay men around. I have heard the stories where...
Yeah, I'm pretty aware of that.
Right. And that rape is not going to be considered as rape. If you look at it, according to the definition of rape, it is having sexual intercourse or intimacy with someone who is not willing for that.
Consent is not...
There's no consent in it. So as long as you are having non-consensual sex with someone, it is rape.
Yeah.
However, our laws define it very gender specific, that it is something that has to do with women only.
So we should have a law that encompasses both genders, or like everybody who's ever been non-consensually touched.
So anyone who has non-consensual sex with another person, it's going to be a rape. Even if it is within homosexuals or heterosexuals or otherwise, a rape is a rape.
That's true.
So that is what eventually happened. So I took help from Hamsafa Trust. I went through counseling. I want to mention the names because they deserve it. Richa Vashish was counseling me in Hamsafa Trust. And Sonal Jiani, she helped me with understanding how the legal procedures can go ahead. She made me sit and told me that this all things will happen. Are you willing to go ahead with that? I had no one to tell me that, you know, please do that. My roommate told me that don't do it, there's nothing that is going to happen. But I did it, even though I got to, I mean, people had been telling me don't do it, don't do it, don't do it. I did it, not because I thought there's something that can happen, or not because I thought that I will get a positive result in the end. I did it because I wanted a feeling that I did not give up in between. And what good am I if I am giving up in between? How am I going to tell others that you can fight too?
And by keeping quiet, you're enabling the villains in the picture.
Exactly. You're enabling the villains in the picture, and at the same time, you're making others weak.
Yeah.
You're not making yourself weak, but you're making others weak.
True.
And I couldn't take a blame on me that I didn't do enough from my end.
True.
So I went ahead with that. They put me in touch with the Lawyers Collective, where Sunraj was the lawyer whom I spoke to. He helped me drafting the FIR. Sonal also helped
and
me.
And Lawyers Collective, do they charge you, or how is it?
So they work with Hamsafar Trust because for all the LGBT or gender related issues, Hamsafar has always approached
Lawyers Collective. And they are funded also in a way.
Yeah. So right now in that particular scenario, both the people, they had helped me throughout, and in the whole process, because I had to travel through in the crowd, in the train, a friend of mine who is also one of the co-members from Game Bombay, Charles Arthur Williams, he had been a great help throughout. I mean, he actually took the pain to take a time off to take me to the Lawyers Collective, bring me back and things like that. So he had been a really great help. And all these people have empowered me in a way where I am right now. Eventually, that FIO was taken into consideration. The policemen at car station, they were quite helpful, surprisingly.
But how much time did it take between you filing the FIR and this actually getting started?
So, getting started as in the action?
Yeah, because somebody actually acting on the FIR, you know? Because we also hear like Indian judiciary is not so swift sometimes.
That's Indian Bollywood movies where you get to see that police is always late. But thankfully, the moment the FIR was lodged, the police started taking action straight away.
Oh, sweet.
Something might have triggered them as well for the reason that it has been associated with NGO. That's the reason. I'm not going to say that, you know, police is always going to be helpful, because there are instances where police have proved themselves to be not helpful. So I'm not going to say that, you know, you have the, I'm not going to give out the information to people saying that, oh, you can go straight away and do that. I would still suggest take help of NGOs, whichever you can find, or counselors, or anyone whom you can find and approach.
Lawyer up.
Yes.
Lawyer up, definitely.
Exactly.
But and we, that again, like the cop situation again, it's a very, like, you know, this good and this bad. There are men who come out and stand with us during the Pride. And they are always there, but there are also men who run extortion rackets to, you know, find people who are gay in the vicinity and then use that against them.
True.
So you can't say it's, if it's like win-win or it's a win-lose, rather. It's sometimes that, like that.
Exactly. That is why I keep on saying people that take help of NGOs. And because of that, what happened is that the action was taken almost immediately. Within a couple of days, or almost 3, 4, 5 days, the people were behind the bars.
Okay. And what section were they charged with? Would you know that?
I don't remember the sections exactly now. It's almost more than a year.
But how long did they go behind the bars?
Unfortunately, I couldn't keep up because my phone was lost, my number was gone, so I couldn't stay in touch with the policeman. And I'm not sure what happened after that, but yes, the sections were pretty much a lot for them to put them behind the bars for at least 10-15 years.
Justice served.
Yeah, exactly.
Cool. So we'll take another short break here and we'll come back, and this time we'll talk about how you came to terms with it and your family, how did they react to it. All right?
Great.
We'll be back soon.
Every film has a hero, heroine, villain and songs. But what makes a film truly memorable are those great characters like Pappu Pager, Gabbar Singh, Mogambo, Kalender and several others like that. Join me every week as I sit down to talk to brilliant actors who have played some of the most memorable characters in Indian film history. This is Bollywood Scene Stealers. Tune into a new episode every Monday on iTunes, SoundCloud, Audioboom, the IVM podcast app, or any other podcast apps you like.
Hello and welcome back to Keeping It Queer. Divya Roop is with me, and we spoke in length about your early life and the incident that happened to you, and you know that in a way shaped a lot for you as well. But today, as you walk out as a gay individual, how do you feel? What do you think about it? When, because you know, going out, stepping out itself is such a big deal some days. So what do you tell yourself to get out?
There's only one thing that I can think of when I'm going out, and that is, I will survive this. And I'm strong enough to face anything.
And Gloria Gaynor in the background.
Yeah, I will survive. That happens. But I think whatever has happened in my life throughout till today, it has only empowered me and made me more accepting and knowledgeable, which in turn makes me as a strong person within myself. I mean, I have my ups and downs. I have times where I have quite happy moments, quite sad moments. Those are all there. But what's a human being who doesn't have those?
Yeah, if you don't have up and downs, then probably your pulse is gone.
Exactly, like dead already.
Yeah. So I want to just go into the because you said you travel so much, and then when you came to New Delhi is when you really wanted to experiment with your gender, and you know, you decided that you don't conform with either of them. So how was the news to your family?
So right now, I came out to myself in bits and pieces. I came out to myself as a gay person first, and then I came out to myself as a genderqueer, non-conforming, androgynous person eventually. For my parents and my family, it was not really easy for them to digest it, considering, as I said, Bihari family, male chauvinism is already there. So they couldn't really understand. My father is a man of science. He won't talk about illogical things. He will put in front of me all the science that he could. And since I'm also a student of science, so I also give him back with the science. So eventually what happened is that my father realized that I have backed up myself quite a lot. And I have studied enough that whatever he brings into the picture, that will be countered. So he gave up on that. And like, I don't want to talk about your sexuality. Let's just keep it to yourself.
But don't you like this small part of you that just finds happiness in the fact that you now schooling your parents, like, you know, like all through life, we learn most of the stuff from them. And then now we discovered something amazing, which is out there. And now we're using it, you know, yellow daddy, you know, counter arguments. And I feel happy, like sometimes in front of myself.
I won't say that I feel happy, but I felt
you do a little bit of victory dance in your head.
Yeah, like I now my father doesn't have anything to counter now. Okay, cool. So that means I'm one plus. So I knew that my father isn't going to be easy, and I never expected my mother to be difficult. But eventually, I realized that my mother was more difficult than my father. but yes, they still haven't came in terms with it, and they're still taking time, and I am not sure how long they're going to take, but let's just keep it as we hope it gets better.
Yeah, fingers crossed. But then they come around usually.
Yeah.
And you know, like with most Indian parents, because they have never spoken about it for the most part of their lives, now when they're in their 40s, they suddenly get this news and they're like, oh my God. So, and this is the kind of thing we've maintained throughout the show, is that our parents are eventually going to be the ones who give birth to us. And,
exactly.
And they get us eventually. But it just takes time, and we hope that your parents also come around.
I hope so too. The only person in my whole family that had been understanding, as I mentioned, was my Juju, who had told me about the Vikruti and Prakruti fact. So he was the only person who actually spoke to me for actually like throughout the day, from the morning till the evening. Took me on a coffee date and spoke to me as well.
How adorable.
He's a gem of a person. So finally he told me that Divya, I don't see anything wrong with you. I have had he works in bank, Bank of Montreal, I guess, if he has not changed. So he told me he have had two managers who were like me, and he accepted, saying those are the two managers who had been the most compassionate and most amazing managers he has ever met. And he doesn't think, he doesn't feel that there's anything wrong in me or any of a person like me. He won't use the word gay himself, but he kept it to that. So he said, I don't see any kind of problems with you people, because if a person would have had a mental problem, that person might not have spoken so much like you do about politics or education or anything. You have a good brain, so you know what you're doing, and I think I don't have anything to worry about you.
So by the end of this, we discover that blood supply to your brain is equal to your blood supply to the penis. So keep the balance keep the balance going. And and would you like to give a final word before we leave?
The only thing that I'm going to say here for the listeners, education is the only thing that is going to help you out. And no matter what, as long as the person is not harming anyone, or be it another person or themselves, I don't think that person should be discriminated or should be left out. That's what I can say.
It's amazing. And if violence happens, lawyer up.
Lawyer up, yes.
And that's our episode for today. Thank you so much, Divya, for coming and talking to us. I hope all the listeners learn from your struggles and learn from your bravery. And we end this episode on a good note. Yes. All right, so let's keep it queer and have fun.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. Well, if you enjoyed the show, you can listen to more of it on any of the podcasting apps you like. You can look out for us on Audioboom, Pocket Cast, Stitcher, Beyond Pod. But if you're looking for us on the iTunes India store, you might have a bit of a trouble finding us because of the language used on the show. So be sure to change your location and then listen to us. For now, it's me, Navin Narona, signing off. Goodbye. Thank you so much. And please continue keeping it queer.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is your captain speaking. Sorry to say, but there's been a slight delay due to the apocalypse having suddenly begun. As you can see, there's death, destruction, and chaos taking place all around us. But don't you worry, food and drinks will be served shortly, and I would recommend checking out
IVM Podcasts
to get some of your favorite Indian podcasts. We'll keep you going till this whole thing blows over. Thank you.